for the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity. And there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
Terry,
things.
How do you think
like
the Canadian Prime Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented the evidence likely in the Parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate. And remember that when your prime minister basically punches our prime minister in the nose rhetorically, I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused them of, then there's already been some escalation, let's agree. But the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Jaishankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get more
calm. It's not looking good. It's not looking good at all
No.
between India and Canada right now, and it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India, and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Terry?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. The Canadian public doesn't. Not yet. In the next couple of days, may see some leaks, may learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare-knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. Either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened, that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada. And over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different standards. And Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Canada is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll spare you some of the details, just mention one. The Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was, India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations, and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity. And there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, the Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
Jerry, how
things
do you think
like
the
the
Canadian
referendum,
Prime
which
Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented the evidence, likely in the Parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy, rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate. And remember that when your prime minister basically punches our prime minister in the nose rhetorically, I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused him of, then there's already been some escalation, okay. Let's agree. But the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Jaishankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get more
calm. It's not looking good.
Calm.
It's not looking good at all
No.
between India and Canada right now, and it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India, and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Terry?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget True. Diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. The Canadian public doesn't. Not yet. In the next couple of days, they see some leaks, they learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare-knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. Either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada. And over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different, you've got to understand, there are different standards, and Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, yes. blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Canada is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll say that some of the details, just mention one, the Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was, India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity. And there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, the Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
things. How do you think the Canadian Prime Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented the evidence likely in the Parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate. And remember that when your prime minister punches our prime minister in the nose rhetorically, I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused him of, then there's already been some escalation, let's agree. But the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Joshankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get more
calm. It's not looking good.
Calm.
It's not looking good at all between India and Canada right now. And it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India, and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Derek?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget True. Diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. The Canadian public doesn't, not yet. In the next couple of days, they see some leaks, they learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. So either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened, that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada. And over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different, you've got to understand, there are different standards. And Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll say some of the details, just mention one. The Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was, India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity. And there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, the Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
Terry,
things.
How do you think
like the
Canadian Prime Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented the evidence likely in the Parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate. And remember that when your prime minister basically punches our prime minister in the nose rhetorically, I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused him of, then there's already been some escalation, let's agree. But the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Jaishankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful.
It's not looking good at all between India and Canada right now. And it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Ted?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. The Canadian public doesn't. Not yet. In the next couple of days, may see some leaks, may learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. Either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada, and over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different standards, and Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, yes, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Canada is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll spare you some of the details, just mention one. The Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was, India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity. And there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, the Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
Terry,
things.
How do you think
like
the Canadian Prime Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented the evidence likely in the parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate. And remember that when your prime minister basically punches our prime minister in the nose rhetorically, I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused him of, then there's already been some escalation, let's agree. But the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Jaishankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up. and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get more
calm. It's not looking good.
Calm.
It's not looking good at all between India and Canada right now, and it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India, and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Terry?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. The Canadian public doesn't. Not yet. In the next couple of days, they see some leaks, they learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. Either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened, that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada. And over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different standards. And Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Canada is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll spare you some of the details, just mention one. The Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was, India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity. And there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, the Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some things.
How do you think
like
the Canadian Prime Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented their evidence likely in the parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate. And remember that when your prime minister punches our prime minister in the nose rhetorically, I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused him of, then there's already been some escalation, let's agree. But the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Joshankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get more
calm. It's not looking good. It's not looking good at all between India and Canada right now. And it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India, and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Terry?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. the Canadian public doesn't, not yet. In the next couple of days, they see some leaks, they learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. Either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened, that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada. And over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different standards. And Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Canada is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll say some of the details, just mention one. The Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was, India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations, and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity. And there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, the Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
Terry,
things.
How do you think
like the
Canadian Prime Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented the evidence likely in the parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate. And remember that when your prime minister basically punches our prime minister in the nose rhetorically. I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused him of, then there's already been some escalation. Okay. Let's agree. But the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Jaishankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get more
calm. It's not looking good. It's not looking good at all between India and Canada right now, and it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India, and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Terry?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. The Canadian public doesn't. Not yet. In the next couple of days, they see some leaks, they learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare-knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. Either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada. And over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different standards. And Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Canada is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll Some of the details, just mentioned one, the Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was, India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity. And there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
things. How do you think the Canadian Prime Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented the evidence likely in the Parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate. And remember that when your prime minister basically punches our prime minister in the nose rhetorically, I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused them of, then there's already been some escalation, let's agree. But the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Jaishankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get more
calm. It's not looking good. It's not looking good at all between India and Canada right now, and it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India, and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Terry?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. The Canadian public doesn't. Not yet. In the next couple of days, they see some leaks, they learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare-knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. Either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened, that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada. And over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different, you've got to understand, there are different standards. And Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Canada is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll spare you some of the details, just mention one. The Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was, India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity, and there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
Terry,
things.
How do you think
like
the Canadian Prime Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented the evidence, likely in the Parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy, rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate, and remember that when your Prime Minister basically punches our Prime Minister in the nose rhetorically. I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused him of, then there's already been some escalation, let's agree. But the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Jaishankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get more
calm. It's not looking good. It's not looking good at all between India and Canada right now. And it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India, and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Terry?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. The Canadian public doesn't. Not yet. In the next couple of days, they see some leaks, they learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare-knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. Either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened, that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada. And over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different standards. And Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, yes, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Canada is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll say some of the details, just mention one. The Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was, India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity, and there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, the Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
Terry,
things.
How do you think
like
the Canadian Prime Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented the evidence likely in the Parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate. And remember that when your prime minister punches our prime minister in the nose rhetorically, I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused him of, then there's already been some escalation, let's agree. But the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Jaishankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up. and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get more
calm. It's not looking good. It's not looking good at all between India and Canada right now, and it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India, and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Derek?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. The Canadian public doesn't. Not yet. In the next couple of days, they see some leaks. They learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare-knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. Either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened, that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada. And over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different standards. And Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Canada is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll spare you some of the details, just mention one. The Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was, India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity. And there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
Terry,
things.
How do you think
like the
Canadian Prime Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented the evidence likely in the Parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate. And remember that when your prime minister basically punches our prime minister in the nose rhetorically, I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused him of, then there's already been some escalation, let's agree. But the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Jaishankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get more
calm. It's not looking good. It's not looking good at all between India and Canada right now, and it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Terry?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. the Canadian public doesn't, not yet. In the next couple of days, may see some leaks, may learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare-knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. Either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened, that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada. And over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different standards. And Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Canada is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll spare you some of the details, just mention one. The Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was, India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations, and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity. And there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, the Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
Terry,
things.
How do you think
like
the Canadian Prime Minister
which
should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented the evidence likely in the parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate. And remember that when your prime minister basically punches our prime minister in the nose rhetorically. I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused them of, then there's already been some escalation. Okay. Let's agree. And but the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Jaishankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get more
calm. It's not looking good. It's not looking good at all between India and Canada right now, and it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India, and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Terry?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. The Canadian public doesn't. Not yet. In the next couple of days, may see some leaks, may learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare-knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. Either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada. And over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different standards. And Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Canada is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll spare you the, Some of the details, just mentioned one, the Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was, India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity. And there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, the Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
things. How do you think the Canadian Prime Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented their evidence likely in the Parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate. And remember that when your prime minister punches our prime minister in the nose rhetorically, I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused them of, then there's already been some escalation, let's agree. But the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Joshankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get more
calm. It's not looking good. It's not looking good at all between India and Canada right now. And it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India, and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Terry?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. The Canadian public doesn't, not yet. In the next couple of days, they see some leaks, they learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. That's so true. Either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada. And over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different, you've got to understand, there are different standards. And Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Canada is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll say some of the details, just mention one. The Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was, India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity. And there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
Terry,
things.
How do you think
like
the Canadian Prime Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented the evidence likely in the Parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate. And remember that when your prime minister punches our prime minister in the nose rhetorically, I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused him of, then there's already been some escalation, let's agree. But the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Jaishankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get more
calm. It's not looking good. It's not looking good at all between India and Canada right now. And it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India, and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Derek?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. The Canadian public doesn't. Not yet. In the next couple of days, they see some leaks. They learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. Either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada, and over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different standards, and Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, yes, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Canada is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll spare you some of the details, just mention one. The Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was, India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity. And there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
Terry,
things.
How do you think
like the
Canadian Prime Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented the evidence likely in the parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate. And remember that when your prime minister basically punches our prime minister in the nose rhetorically, I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused him of, then there's already been some escalation, let's agree. But the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Jaishankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up. and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get more
calm. It's not looking good.
Calm.
It's not looking good at all between India and Canada right now, and it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India, and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Terry?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. The Canadian public doesn't. Not yet. In the next couple of days, they see some leaks. They learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare-knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. Either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada. And over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different standards. And Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Canada is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll spare you some of the details, just mention one. The Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was, India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity. And there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
Terry,
things.
How do you think
like
the Canadian Prime Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented the evidence likely in the parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate. And remember that when your prime minister basically punches our prime minister in the nose rhetorically, I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused them of, then there's already been some escalation, let's agree. But the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Jaishankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get
more. It's not looking good.
Calm.
It's not looking good at all between India and Canada right now. And it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India, and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Ted?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. the Canadian public doesn't, not yet. In the next couple of days, may see some leaks, may learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. Either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada, and over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different standards, and Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Canada is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll spare you some of the details, just mention one. The Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was, India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations, and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity. And there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, the Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
Terry,
things.
How do you think
like
the Canadian Prime Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented the evidence likely in the parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate. And remember that when your prime minister basically punches our prime minister in the nose rhetorically. I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused him of, then there's already been some escalation. Okay. Let's agree. And but the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Jaishankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get
more. It's not looking good. It's not looking good at all between India and Canada right now, and it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India, and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Terry?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. The Canadian public doesn't. Not yet. In the next couple of days, they see some leaks, they learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare-knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. Either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada. And over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different standards. And Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Canada is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll Some of the details, just mentioned one, the Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was, India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity. And there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
things. How do you think the Canadian Prime Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented the evidence likely in the Parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate. And remember that when your prime minister basically punches our prime minister in the nose rhetorically, I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused them of, then there's already been some escalation, let's agree. But the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Jaishankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get more
calm. It's not looking good. It's not looking good at all between India and Canada right now. And it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India, and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Terry?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, OK, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. The Canadian public doesn't, not yet. In the next couple of days, may see some leaks, may learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. Either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada. And over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different standards. And Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Canada is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll spare you some of the details, just mention one. The Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was, India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity. And there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters, painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
things. How do you think the Canadian Prime Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented the evidence likely in the Parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate. And remember that when your prime minister basically punches our prime minister in the nose rhetorically, I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused him of, then there's already been some escalation, let's agree. But the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Jaishankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get more
calm. It's not looking good. It's not looking good at all between India and Canada right now. And it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India, and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Terry?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. The Canadian public doesn't. Not yet. In the next couple of days, they see some leaks, they learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. Either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened, that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada. And over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different standards. And Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, yes, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Canada is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll say that some of the details, just mention one, the Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was, India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity. And there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
Terry,
things.
How do you think
like
the Canadian Prime Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented the evidence likely in the Parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate. And remember that when your prime minister punches our prime minister in the nose rhetorically, I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused him of, then there's already been some escalation, let's agree. But the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Jaishankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up. and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get more
calm. It's not looking good. It's not looking good at all between India and Canada right now, and it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India, and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Terry?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. The Canadian public doesn't. Not yet. In the next couple of days, they see some leaks, they learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare-knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. Either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened, that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada. And over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different, you've got to understand, there are different standards. And Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Canada is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll spare you some of the details, just mention one. The Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was, India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity. And there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, the Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
Terry,
things.
How do you think
like the
Canadian Prime Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented their evidence likely in the parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate. And remember that when your prime minister punches our prime minister in the nose rhetorically, I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused him of, then there's already been some escalation, let's agree. But the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Jaishankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get more
calm. It's not looking good. It's not looking good at all between India and Canada right now. And it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India, and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Derek?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. the Canadian public doesn't, not yet. In the next couple of days, may see some leaks, may learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare-knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. Either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada, and over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different standards, and Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Canada is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll spare you some of the details, just mention one. The Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was, India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity. And there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
Terry,
things.
How do you think
like the
Canadian Prime Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented the evidence likely in the parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate. And remember that when your prime minister basically punches our prime minister in the nose rhetorically. I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused them of, then there's already been some escalation. Okay. Let's agree. But the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Jaishankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get
more. It's
not
looking good.
Calm.
It's not looking good at all between India and Canada right now. And it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India, and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Terry?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. The Canadian public doesn't. Not yet. In the next couple of days, may see some leaks, may learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare-knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. Either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada. And over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different standards. And Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Canada is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll stay the, Some of the details, just mentioned one, the Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was, India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity. And there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, the Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
things. How do you think the Canadian Prime Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented the evidence likely in the Parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate. And remember that when your prime minister punches our prime minister in the nose rhetorically, I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused them of, then there's already been some escalation, let's agree. But the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Joshankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get more
calm. It's not looking good. It's not looking good at all between India and Canada right now. And it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India, and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Terry?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. The Canadian public doesn't. Not yet. In the next couple of days, they see some leaks. They learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare-knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. That's so true. Either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada. And over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different, you've got to understand, there are different standards. And Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Canada is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll say some of the details, just mention one. The Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was, India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity. And there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
Terry,
things.
How do you think
like
the Canadian Prime Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented the evidence likely in the Parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate. And remember that when your prime minister punches our prime minister in the nose rhetorically, I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused him of, then there's already been some escalation, let's agree. But the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Jaishankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get more
calm. It's not looking good. It's not looking good at all between India and Canada right now. And it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India, and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Derek?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. The Canadian public doesn't. Not yet. In the next couple of days, they see some leaks. They learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare-knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. Either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada, and over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different standards, and Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, yes, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Canada is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll spare you some of the details, just mention one. The Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was, India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity, and there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
Terry,
things.
How do you think
like the
Canadian Prime Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented the evidence likely in the parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate. And remember that when your prime minister basically punches our prime minister in the nose rhetorically, I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused him of, then there's already been some escalation, let's agree. But the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Jaishankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up. and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get more
calm. It's not looking good.
Calm.
It's not looking good at all between India and Canada right now, and it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India, and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Terry?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. The Canadian public doesn't. Not yet. In the next couple of days, they see some leaks. They learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare-knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. Either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada. And over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different standards. And Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Canada is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll spare you some of the details, just mention one. The Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was, India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity. And there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
Terry,
things.
How do you think
like
the Canadian Prime Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented the evidence likely in the parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate. And remember that when your prime minister basically punches our prime minister in the nose rhetorically, I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused them of, then there's already been some escalation, let's agree. But the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Jaishankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get
more. It's not looking good.
Calm.
It's not looking good at all between India and Canada right now, and it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India, and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Terry?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. the Canadian public doesn't, not yet. In the next couple of days, may see some leaks, may learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. Either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada. And over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different standards. And Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Canada is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll spare you some of the details, just mention one. The Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was, India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity. And there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, the Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
things. How do you think the Canadian Prime Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented the evidence likely in the parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate. And remember that when your prime minister basically punches our prime minister in the nose rhetorically. I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused him of, then there's already been some escalation. Okay. Let's agree. But the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Jaishankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get more.
It's not looking good. It's not looking good at all between India and Canada right now, and it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India, and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Terry?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. The Canadian public doesn't. Not yet. In the next couple of days, they see some leaks. They learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare-knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. Either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada. And over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different standards. And Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Canada is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll Some of the details, just mentioned one, the Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity. And there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
things. How do you think the Canadian Prime Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented the evidence likely in the Parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate. And remember that when your prime minister basically punches our prime minister in the nose rhetorically, I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused them of, then there's already been some escalation, let's agree. But the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Jaishankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get more
calm. It's not looking good. It's not looking good at all between India and Canada right now, and it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India, and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Terry?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. The Canadian public doesn't, not yet. In the next couple of days, they see some leaks, they learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the bare knuckle brawl, where they're going to have to both show their cards. And it's going to be a painful period, I think, especially for the Canadian government, because we've taken the initiative. We have said that these are credible allegations of a potential link. Well, they can say potential all they like, but they've acted on it. They've already taken action. They've already kicked out a senior diplomat from the Indian High Commission. So if they're already acting on it, it's got to be more than potential, hasn't it? And they better prove it. Either they prove it in short order and come up with some good evidence, or Trudeau is finished.
That's the big point you're making. Why not put in the evidence if you were so strongly convinced that this was India, so to say, behind the killing of the extremist? But also my second question here, Terry, you've been writing on these books and about Khalistan movement, not recently, but ever since the Kanishka bombing has happened, that led to the loss of life, even of Canadian citizens. So this is not just about India or India's concerns, but it concerns Canada as much. How do you think that this reflects politically? Is this vote bank? Is this political pressure? Because there are a lot of people who would disagree to how a Canadian Prime Minister is literally attempting to break down relationship between India and Canada. And over what? Over an extremist who India wanted to be extradited.
Yes, well, there are different standards. And Canada doesn't necessarily have to agree with everything that India tells it. India can say, we want these terrorists extradited, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
Canada is entitled, any government is, to look at it and say, well, I'm sorry, that evidence doesn't meet our standards. And so the answer is no. And that there's a long history and a painful one between India and Canada on that issue. I'll spare you some of the details, just mention one. The Air India bomber, the Kanishka bombing of 1985. He was, India asked for his extradition in 1982, 3 years before the bombing. They outed him as a wanted international terrorist and the murderer of two policemen in India. And the father of Justin Trudeau, Pierre Trudeau, was the prime minister and said no to Indira Gandhi. No, you can't have him. So there's a long history of Canada saying your standards aren't our standards. We don't think you've got the evidence. Well, now the tables are turned. That's the important thing. It's Canada who's making the accusations and Canada who better substantiate them. Because if they can't, this is going to be a fiasco, and it could be Justin Trudeau's last fiasco in power.
Terry, do tell us this, because you've been tracking this for so long. How is this seen in Canada? Because here from India, we see constant rallies that are being organized. When Trudeau was being snubbed here in the G20, while he was here present and being given the best hospitality, even though, of course, the bilaterals did not take place, there was a referendum by the Khalistanis that were taking place in Canada on Canadian soil, and that was clearly an anti-India activity, and there have been many such referendums in the past. What happens to Canada here on? Because this is a boost to the Canadian, to the pro-Khalistan extremists there.
Well, it remains to be seen what price Canada is going to have to pay for upping the ante by escalating the existing dispute to this very high level. You mentioned the referendum. There's no doubt that's an important irritant. But in Canada, it's perfectly legal if people want to get together and have a peaceful vote. We're talking now about something that is not peaceful. We're talking about murder on the streets of Canada. And so that's something else completely. The Indians may complain about the referendum. That's not really the issue, frankly. I mean, they've got better things to complain about. For example, Khalistanis in Canada who are parading through the streets celebrating the assassination of Indira Gandhi. Khalistanis in Canada who are putting up posters painting targets on the backs of Indian diplomats by saying these men are killers because they're all accused collectively of being guilty of the assassination of Hardeep Nijjar in Surrey. So there are some
Terry,
things.
How do you think
like
the Canadian Prime Minister should have gone about this? Do you think they should have presented the evidence, likely in the Parliament, then maybe sacked the diplomat, then maybe summoned the envoy, rather than say credible allegations and we sack the diplomat?
Well, it may be so, but remember that Modi has escalated as well. I mean, it takes two to escalate, and remember that when your Prime Minister basically punches our Prime Minister in the nose rhetorically. I mean, by telling him that Canada is harboring people who are threatening the lives of our diplomats, which is exactly what Modi accused him of, then there's already been some escalation, let's agree. But the thing is now is that Trudeau has turned it up about as high as it can go. When you start kicking out diplomats, there's not a whole lot more you can do short of declaring war. So this is, in diplomatic terms, this is the highest level. I would expect India to respond quickly and in like manner. I don't think Foreign Minister Jaishankar's statement is the end of it by any means. I think we'll probably see a tit-for-tat expulsion. Maybe India may even go higher, go all the way up and kick out the High Commissioner. Who knows what we'll see in the days ahead? But it's not going to get more peaceful. It's not going to get more
calm. It's not looking good. It's not looking good at all between India and Canada right now. And it remains to be seen how the relationship progresses. I really appreciate you, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist, written books on Khalistan, has been tracking the movement for decades now. Thank you so much for joining us on India Today. Let's get you a perspective from experts, those who have understood the Khalistan extremism, the ideology, the movement, and how it has harmed India, and it's going to eventually harm Canada too. Joining me, Terry Milewski. He's a senior journalist. He's written books on Khalistan. So he is the expert that we have on the panel right now. Terry, you tell us that what do you make of this statement by the Canadian Prime Minister? For years, India has been putting out lists after list, telling Canada there is enough evidence against Canadian soil being misused against India. Then Canadian Prime Minister actually blames India for the killing. What do you have on this, Derek?
Well, relations are now going to go from what was previously cool and then frosty after the G20. Now they're in the deep freeze. You can forget diplomacy really from here on in, can you not? I think we can forget that. It's going to be a bare knuckles brawl now as the two governments compete for credibility. What is Trudeau's? Well, Trudeau is down in the polls. He had a bad time at the G20. He was somewhat humiliated by Prime Minister Modi over this issue. So he's fighting back. He's saying, okay, well, we've got you. We're going to implicate your government in a murder on Canadian soil. Well, he's going to have to offer some specifics. He's not going to be able to get away, I don't believe, with saying, oh, well, that's classified, can't talk about it. He's going to have to come up with some goods. He's going to have to come up with real evidence in order to persuade people that he's not just blowing smoke. And the same applies, I should say, to Prime Minister Modi. His government has got to do more than just say, no, it ain't so. They've got to answer whatever it is Trudeau has to offer. And they know what Trudeau has to offer. I don't. The Canadian public doesn't. Not yet. In the next couple of days, may see some leaks, may learn more. But in answer to that, Prime Minister Modi is going to have to come out and say that's wrong because X and Y and Z. So that's what I mean by the best.